welcome to Book Lust. I'm Nancy Pearl. My guest today is novelist Meg Waite Clayton. Meg, so nice to see you almost in person.
Almost in person. Really lovely, Nancy. Thank you for having me on your show. I'm really delighted.
So your new book, which I loved, The Postmistress of Paris, is your seventh novel. Oh, before we begin, we're both University of Michigan grads, undergraduate, go blue, and I almost wore my Michigan cap, and I thought, wouldn't it be fun if we sang Hail to the Victors Valiant? But I did think better of it. So will you talk about...
We need to call in my son for that because he has a beautiful singing voice. I don't know where he got it from. He did not inherit it from me. So
yes, I remember that one time when I was in elementary school, they told me to just to voice, you know, to pretend I'm singing, but not really sing. So I went into other fields of endeavor. Could you talk about how you became a writer, how it happened?
Oh, that's interesting. The way I became a writer is I will say that I went to not only to Michigan undergraduate, but also to Michigan law school. And I loved it there. I went from there to Los Angeles and practiced law. But I went to law school because I didn't know what else I would do. And I was happy as a lawyer, working all the time, doing merger and acquisition work. And I came home late one night to my husband, as I was wont to do. I already had one child, and I typically worked 100-hour weeks as a lawyer. So there was very little time for anything else. And so I came home one night, and my husband said to me, poured me a glass of wine. So is there anything else you'd like to be? meaning you'd like to have more time with me. And I said, you know, I've got a law degree. I'm pretty good at what I'm doing. And he said, you know, set aside what you know you can do, because he knows how type A I am. If you could be anything in the world, what would it be? And I said, well, if I could be anything in the world, I would be a novelist. But like, that's going to happen, ha ha. And he said, sort of really without missing a beat, well, how are you going to know if you can do it or not if you don't give it a try? So I didn't exactly jump off the train, you know, off the legal train the next day. And when I did, I will tell you, it took me 10 years to get my first novel published. But I did eventually start writing and making a go of it. And that I started by... I didn't know what I was doing. I started by taking a class in writing and just trying to start to figure it out. I've always been a huge reader, and I think that's what you need to be a writer. You need to be a huge reader.
Yeah, I absolutely agree with you. And I remember somebody once asked the novelist Ernest Gaines, did he have any advice, or what did you need to be a writer? And he said, well, he has eight words of advice. Read, read, read. Write.
Yeah, so he's amazing.
That's only six words. Read. Write.
Yeah. He was at one of the things I did fairly early in my career before I ever published anything was I went to the Sewanee Writers Conference, and he was one of the teachers there, and he was an amazingly wise and kind person. So
he was.
And when you read his books, you never forget his characters.
You never do. Right.
For you, with the books that you choose to read, what's most important to you, the characters or the language or the plot, the setting?
As a reader, I have to say, I think all of the above. And I would say that is something that being a writer has changed in me, because I just used to gobble up everything and indiscriminately. And after I started writing and learning about writing, I started to be more critical of what I read. And so I think character is very important. I think language is very important, but obviously if you don't have plot, you don't have story. So I think they're all intertwined. And I like, you know, amazing books like Alice McDermott's Charming Billy, where you have this amazing central character of Billy and beautiful, beautiful language and a plot that keeps peeling away layers so that you learn something new almost on every page.
Mm-hmm. What makes you stop reading a book?
I guess the answer is that if it doesn't engage me. Uh-huh. So I usually try to give a book at least, you know, 20 or 30 pages. Sometimes I'll set a book aside and pick it up, you know, 2 weeks later, 2 months later, 2 years later, 2 decades later, and find that that just wasn't the right moment for that book for me. Right. And find I love the book. So I rarely will give away a book, although my house is overrun with books now, so I have been actually giving them away by the hundreds. But but I will say that as I become more discriminate, I usually know within a few pages whether this is a book for me or not. And there are so many books in the world. And honestly, not every book is for every reader. So I can not love a really amazing book, and that's okay. It's just not it's not something that touches something in me. That's, I think, what writing needs to do, is it needs to touch something inside the reader.
Yeah, you just said everything that I've always believed. And said it, I'm afraid, much better than I've ever said it.
I doubt that.
But I do think that so much of why we like a book or not depends on mood, where we are in our lives, what we need at that particular moment. And I too have had that experience of not enjoying a book and putting it aside. And then somebody else will mention it 2 years later or a decade later, and then I'll go back to it and find, oh my gosh, it's just one of my favorite books now.
Exactly. And I think this is one of the reasons I love independent bookstores, is because they are, you know, booksellers, there are readers, and they know. I remember when the book Middlesex came out, and I was up at Books Passage for an event myself, I think, and one of the booksellers put that in my hand. I always ask, you know, what are you reading? Right. And she put that in my hands and said, you want to read this? And I said, oh, you know, I've read about this, but I don't really think it's a book for me. And she looked at me and she said, it's the book for you. It's going to win the Pulitzer Prize. This is before it had. You know? I said, okay, I'll consider that. And I took it home and I did start reading it, and I did absolutely love it. But it's a book that I had already somehow or another made up my mind was not something I was going to read. So I do try to keep a really open mind about what I'm reading.
Right. I remember when, and this was decades ago, when the Random House, I was working at a bookstore, an independent bookstore in Tulsa, Oklahoma, and I remember the Random House rep came in and he said, oh, you've got to read Midnight's Children. He said, it's the best novel ever. And you know, I tried. It was very hard going at first. I just wasn't in the right place for it, because it takes, you have to sort of get into the place. You have to get into India in 1947 to just love it. But it was the language of that that really carried me along when I went back to it. And then it became one of my favorite books. When you write books that are both set in the past and contemporary fiction, do they come to you with equal ease?
So that's an interesting look at it. I will say, the Postmistress of Paris is actually my eighth novel, I think. Yeah, my eighth novel. And the last four have been very solidly historical fiction. Right. My first novel was a very quiet little novel. It was a contemporary novel, but with a Vietnam past backstory, and so deeply steeped in history. My second novel is called The Wednesday Sisters. It was set in the 1960s and 70s, women who wouldn't in a million years call themselves feminists at the dawn of the women's movement. And I always thought of that book as historical fiction, because I was alive in the 60s and 70s, but I was quite young. And in the 60s was a period that I studied in college as a history major at University of Michigan. Yeah, go blue. We're going to do that every time. And then, my publisher then, Libby McGuire at Ballantine, saw it as a contemporary novel, which is, it is in some ways. It's very much about the same kinds of issues that women face today, you know, misbehaving husbands and the kind of medical issues that we face. And it's very much a writer's book that's very relevant for anybody writing today. So she had me, she thought of me as a contemporary writer, and I would pitch all these historical novels. And she would say, we're worried about you losing your audience. Don't you want to write another contemporary novel? And so I actually ended up going to HarperCollins in order to write the kind of deeply just historical fiction that I love to read and kind of imagine myself as a writer of. And so for me, it is much easier to write historical fiction because I can find something that's really interesting in history and explore the depths of it. I love to research. I love to travel. And so I'm always going to different places in my writing. And so I would say historical fiction is easier for me, for sure.
Mm-hmm. It's so interesting to me. We talked about, I've talked about this often with other writers when I'm interviewing them, about the fact that oftentimes publishers don't trust readers enough to let an author go where he or she or they want to go.
And I think sometimes publishers have ideas about what readers want that don't always match up with what readers really want. I think when I first pitched what became my fifth novel, the novel that I moved to HarperCollins for, it was called The Race for Paris, and it was about women journalists hoping to be the first to report the liberation of Paris during World War II. It was my first World War II story. And when I pitched it to my team at Ballantine, they felt that women, this was before Kristen Hannah's The Nightingale, they felt that women did not like to read about war. They were concerned that women would not like to read about war. Clearly that market for World War II fiction with strong women protagonists has just ballooned since then. And so I think it's good to keep an open mind for what readers want.
One of the things that I find especially interesting in The Postmistress of Paris and the other historicals is that you use both real people and your imaginary characters and even real people that you have transformed into your other characters. Talk about that and how that works for you as a writer. And
absolutely. Just to ground the people watching here, The Postmistress of Paris is a story about a young American heiress, Chicago-based heiress, who moves to Paris and is living there when Hitler invades. When most expats choose to go home, she instead stays and becomes involved in an effort to struggle to smuggle artists and writers and other intellectuals out of France. The story is based on a real effort led by an American named Varian Fry, who literally went over with a list of names of people he could get American visas for, people like Picasso and Chagall and Hannah Arendt. And there was a real American heiress named Mary Jane Gold, who, you know, always as I'm looking for a story, because I like to write, I'm fine with reading books about with men at their center, but I really feel like women have been underserved in literature to date. And so I like to contribute my literary efforts to giving women, especially forgotten women, some attention. I'm always looking for a female angle in the story. And I found this a real American heiress named Mary Jane Gold. Mary Jane Gold did a lot of the things that are in the book. You know, one of the things in the book is there's a dog. His name is Dagobert, and he barks madly every time anybody says Hitler. The real Mary Jane Gold really did have a dog who really did bark whenever anybody
said Hitler. I wondered about that.
Yeah, sometimes you cannot make it up better than it really happens. But the rest of Mary Jane Gold's story, in particular her love story, would have taken me outside of the kind of box that I was interested in exploring, which was this this effort to get refugees out. And I really came to the story from the angle of the artist Edward. And so what I like to do is if I stick really closely to a real character, like I did with Varian Fry in this book, for example, then I use the real name and I am very careful to honor what they did and to not have them doing things that I know they didn't do and to only fill in the spaces for things that I don't know about.
And there's a lot about surrealism because many of the characters, the artists in the book are surrealists, famous surrealists, André Breton, I don't know how to pronounce his name. Is that a favorite of your, is that a favorite art?
I'm gonna read you one little line from this, which will say how Nene feels about a surrealism and how I feel about surrealism. And keep in mind that Nene is from a town called Evanston. It's north of Chicago. And I grew up also north of Chicago in a less swanky neighborhood than Evanston. But she says, this is the second paragraph of the book, so I'm not spoiling anything. She's in, opens with her in an airplane with she's flying it and Dagobert's beside her. She flew on up the looping Seine, headed back to Paris for the Exposition Internationale de Surrealism, 300 artworks depicting gigantic insects, bizarre floating heads, and dismembered or defiled bodies she knew were meant to be thought-provoking, but always left her feeling unsophisticated and far too American, Midwestern, not even from Chicago, but from Evanston. That's the way I feel about surrealism. I didn't know a whole lot about it before I started researching the book, and I found it quite intimidating as an art form. It's one of the fun things about becoming a writer is you can poke into things that you don't know about and learn things. I spent a lot of time in art exhibits and reading about the surrealists and what they did, and I came to greatly admire why the surrealists created the art they did. And nonetheless, there are very few works of surrealist art that I would want to hang on my bedroom wall. They mostly would give me nightmares.
Right. I was just going to say that. One of the most moving parts of this very moving novel, The Postmistress of Paris, is when they're crossing the Pyrenees to get out of France into Spain and then onto Portugal. And I when I read it, I got like little prickles all over because my father fought in the Spanish Civil War against Franco, and it was illegal for Americans to enter Spain when he was going there. And so he had to walk over one of his great stories is, of course, landing in France and walking over the Pyrenees to get to Spain. So that
it was the way out, and it's such a moving way out. And I will say that one of the things I learned in writing this book was I think a lot of the reason I'm so find World War II so fascinating myself is because the big storyteller in my family was my Uncle Jim, who told stories about everything except his experience in World War II. He never spoke of that, not even to his wife or my dad. But late in the process of doing this, I'd already signed the contract for it. I was doing research and stuff. I was in Arles, and I was talking to my dad on the phone in Arles in the south of France, and he said, "Oh, Arles, I think that's where Uncle Jim was shot down." And I said, "Uncle Jim was shot down?" He said, "Oh yeah, that's one of the few things I know about him, that he was shot down." And he was hidden there. And he said, "And then I think somebody helped him escape over the Pyrenees." And I was like, already had this book in mind, and so much of what I'm doing, I think, as I write about World War II is trying to understand Uncle Jim's experience. And there is, you know, this book that I'm writing that's exploring his experience. It was one of those little miracles that happen as you write. So
there's actually a wonderful, I think it's 2-volume graphic novel about about a woman growing up in a family where her father refuses to talk about his experiences in World War II. I wish I could remember the title, but if I can dredge it up, I'll send you it because you might find it really. Really interesting. My father was always too eager and happy to talk about his experiences in pre-World War II Spanish Civil War. How did you find that woman, the character that became Nene?
So I came to it from the artist angle. So I learned about the artists and about Varian Fry's effort to get them out. And so I went trying to learn about it. And one of the things I found to read is that, you know, looking for information, any kind of information I want, is a book called Villa Arbel by Rosemary Sullivan. It happens to be, in the small world of small worlds, it happens to be published by Harper, and actually my editor is her editor. But I didn't know any of that when I found the book. And it goes through through, it's a really lovely exploration of the many characters involved in this effort. And one of them, there are actually two women that she explores in depth, and one was Mary Jane Gold, and the other was Miriam Davenport. And probably I have more in common with Miriam Davenport than I did with Mary Jane Gold. But Miriam exits the story much earlier than Mary Jane Gold did. And Mary Jane was from Chicago, which I'm from, and that connection somehow or another, I feel like where we are from informs us in ways that we don't even realize. It's like the religion we grew up informs us in ways that we don't even realize, even if we have abandoned it later in life. And so I felt like I just fell in love with her. And then everything I read about her made me more in love with her. But it took a long time to find out about her because she did write a memoir, but it's no longer in print in English. And so I got a copy in French and tried to read that and realized that this would be written in my next life if I had to rely on that. So then I found, you'll like this, and being a librarian, I came back to the United States and found an English copy in a library. So
very nice, very nice. Glad to know that. Do you have an idea for your next book, or how much of a break, if there is a break, between finding these characters or topics or a plot?
I am always writing. It is my happy space. As much as I love talking to readers about my books and everything, it's a little outside of my comfort zone. And my comfort zone is really sitting in my little, office playhouse playing with my imaginary friends. And so I am always writing something. I always have a next book ahead of me. So I do have a next book. And what I usually do is I try to research one while I'm writing the next one. And that was more complicated in the writing of this one because of the pandemic. It's impossible, it's been impossible to get to France. It's not been that, even the libraries have been closed. So even getting material has been difficult. But I do have a new story that I'm working on. I always feel a little bit that I'm jinxing myself when I talk about what I'm writing next, because that World War II novel, The Race for Paris, that was going to be my third novel, and it was going to be my fourth novel, and it only became my fifth novel after I stopped talking and saying it was going to be my next novel. But the one I'm the one I'm working on now is set in, again, in World War II Paris, this even more firmly in Paris than this one is. The Postmistress of Paris starts in Paris, but much of it takes place in Marseille and elsewhere in France as well. This one is more firmly rooted in Paris, and it's a book about books. And it draws from a real bit of history that I stumbled upon. I had another idea for a story, and I had an idea for a title. And so I went looking to make sure that nobody else had used that title. And I found something real that is not exactly that title, but it's pretty close to it, and is a better story than I was going to tell. So it's a bit like, the title of The Postmistress of Paris, A Dirty Little Secret. It was the title The Postmistress comes from. At one point in time, I was going to do a story about a French woman who lived in Cassis, who was a forger, and her day job was as a postmistress, or working in a post office. And I thought, oh, that's a great title, The Postmistress of Provence, it was going to be. But then I found this story about the artist, but I liked The Postmistress, and so I kept it and made it a code name for Nene.
Right.
When you get to stories, it's so often, not a direct path.
Yeah, it's so interesting how your mind like brings up little things that you never thought were important or you never thought about, and then they come up in connection with something else.
I always think when people feel like they have to have a whole story before they sit down to write it, I always feel like that would be way too intimidating. I would never be able to sit down and write if I had thought I had to know everything before I started writing that first draft. I often call it, my discovery draft. I don't sometimes know about what a story is really going to be about until I get to the end of that first draft. And then I go, oh, that's what this story is about. And then I have to go back and make it be about that, yeah.
Was the opening of Postmistress of Paris that kind of that scene where Nene is piloting the plane with Dagobert next to her, and there's a swan involved? Was that always the first chapter?
It was always the first chapter, that first paragraph where Nene is in an airplane over Paris with Dago there beside her and headed for this surrealist, back home to Paris where she lives, for this surrealist art exhibit. And that was always how it started. But it didn't have the bird. The bird was not there in the first in the first draft of this. And then I thought, as I was looking back through it, this opening scene needs something a little bit more exciting and daring and dangerous to happen, mm-hmm. to echo the, you know, to kind of lay the way for the exciting and dangerous and daring way that the book unfolds. I like that idea of that first paragraph echoing the whole book and your first opening scene echoing the whole book, so that your book builds on itself, basically. And so in looking for that, I thought, oh, well, I'll put this bird in here and we'll have this trauma. But then, of course, I'm not a pilot. I didn't know what I was doing. So I actually got somebody who is a pilot. We were in lockdown again. So to set up he was so amazing. His name is Christopher Kecht. And he set up the real route that Nene flies on a flight simulator using the specs of the plane that she was flying. We figured them out and everything. So I could see how fast that Eiffel Tower would be approaching as we approached it. And he told me, oh, so if you have if she's flying at this angle, then when that bird comes in, she wouldn't have seen it and then it'll be just there. And so in many ways, that opening seen as a collaboration with Christopher, who was just a lovely person.
My heart was pounding, I have to say. I mean, I knew nothing terrible would happen because the book continues with Nene. So, you know, that was always a comfort to me. Before we end, could you share a couple books that you've really enjoyed? And they don't have to be recent titles, just to share with our audience.
Absolutely. And I'm sorry, I'm coming to you from not my office. Usually I have all my favorite books around me, but my sons are here for the holidays. And so my office is now a room for one of my grown sons is staying in. So I can't show them to you. But one of the ones that I'm recommending again and again now is a one that's called Eva and Otto. It's by three siblings, the Pfisters. One of them, his name is Tom Pfister. He practiced law with me. Knows I'm a writer and asked if he could send me his book, which I didn't know he had published. And I said yes, because you can't say no when somebody wants to send you their book. And I did not imagine that I would have time to read, which is a fairly big book. But it turns out to be a real story about his parents' resistance and escaping over the Pyrenees. I'm going to just say that there's a journal in it and there's a love story and it's an adventure story. It's real. And it is truly one of the most beautiful books that I've read lately. And then I always have my go-to, you know, I'll write anything that Elizabeth Strout writes, I'll read anything that Alice McDermott writes, anything Ann Patchett writes. I have, Ernest Gaines, obviously, when he was writing, was somebody I would read everything of, yeah. And there are actually a couple, there's one that's coming out in March that I would love to tell everybody to look for. It's Karen Joy Fowler, who was the first American shortlisted for the Booker Prize and won the Penn Faulkner. She has a new one coming out called Booth, and it seems like it's about John Wilkes Booth, and it sort of is, but it's very much about his family, and it is, as Karen's books always are, just beautifully written.
Yeah, I have a copy of that at home, and I'm really looking forward to digging into it during in the next couple of weeks. Will you just repeat the title of the book that your law?
The Pfisters, it's called Eva and Otto, and it's Eva ampersand Otto, and it's published by maybe University of Chicago Press. It's published by University Press. Okay. It's probably one that you will have to ask your independent bookseller to order for you, but it, trust me, it is just beautiful, and you should read it.
Yeah. Great. Oh, Meg, thank you so much for coming on the show. I've loved talking to you. I've been a big fan, and I'm so glad this worked out. So happy holidays, and thank you again.
As you know, I'm a huge fan right back to you, and thank you so much for having me, and happy holidays to you.
Bye-bye.